And if you choose to put it in your horse's mouth, then you must understand how, why, and when to use it.
I'm Michelle Drum. I work for the Farmhouse in Landrum, South Carolina, and this is Bit by Bit, the podcast with myself and Adam Rittenberg of AJR Sport.
Yeah, I think it's really fun that we get to do something together and bring a new element of education to the horse world through the eyes and perspective of someone who manufactures bits, and also, you know, a tack shop where the clients go and shop the product. And I think it's Absolutely. A really unique, dynamic aspect of what we're doing, and that they can tune in and hear what we have to say about questions that your clients have, and I can answer through my experience and yours as well.
Absolutely. Tell me a little bit about your background, Adam.
So I grew up in South Florida, where my grandparents had a stable. And at the time I was probably 6 months, I had sat on my first horse. And after that, you know, my passion and love for horses grew from there. So I continued, you know, through some hobby stables and whatnot until I reached a level where I was mentored by Andre Dignelli when I was a junior in the equitation ranks. I did the medal finals, McClay finals. I went to all the equitation finals. And, you know, then I was mentored by Ian Miller in Canada. Of course, doesn't need an introduction for many, many years. And then I went on to Paul Schockemuller stables. I worked for some private stables in Germany, the Netherlands, worked for a guy, a Polish guy. And then I had my own stable as well. I jumped some 4-star Grand Prix. So it was nice to be a part of the sport for a while until I transitioned into another perspective.
How did you get into bit making?
I think it was out of necessity, where I needed a bit. At the time, Valerio Sozzi in Italy was helping me, and I needed this bit, right? And it was a half twist, half straight bit, also known as the Pilot High Flight, which was the horse he used it on, his Olympic mount. And I'm like, where am I going to get this thing, right? There's only one in the world. Where am I going to get this? So I said, well, I better figure out how to make it. And I didn't want to spend the price that a lot of these companies demand for custom. Therefore, I figured out how to do it on my own during lockdown. So I said, you know what, if I need this, well, other people probably need this too. And that's how AJR Sport was born, actually out of necessity. Like most good ideas, it's out of the need for a product.
Very good. Very, very cool. So had you had any experience with metalworking before, or?
So my grandfather was a marine engineer. Before he passed away, he had a huge, huge business where he would develop and, you know, manufacture parts for the cruise line.
Okay.
So funny enough, you know, the fact that I got into fabrication is quite, you know, it's interesting, you know, that
very
it's
kind interesting.
Of, is it genetic, you know, is it in your blood?
Is it DNA? Like,
yeah, is it there somewhere? So, yeah.
So, I guess what should we discuss as our opening for our first podcast? What do you think that people need some education on, or really need to know that maybe we don't know as amateurs in the background about how to bit your horse?
So I think there's a lot of misconception around bits and bitting. And you see, because if you have terrible hands, you shouldn't be sitting on a horse anyway. And if you choose to put it in your horse's mouth, then you must understand how, why, and when to use it.
So what would you suggest to someone who maybe is going through a lot of bits? Like what would be a suggestion on maybe educating your hand?
I think that understanding your horse's anatomy is the first step. You should be working backwards. You should say, does my horse have a fleshy tongue, fleshy lips? Does it have a low palate? Do I even understand my horse? Because if you don't understand your horse, you shouldn't be putting any bit or anything in its mouth except the halter at that point. Do you even know why your horse is frustrated or it's strong? You can have a lovely horse, right? Beautiful character. You're like, this thing is so strong. But he's not a strong-willed, natured horse. He's a kind horse. Why is he pulling my arms out? Well, I can guarantee you there's something making him uncomfortable. He's not going to stop because that's not his nature.
Especially if you have a horse who's maybe built downhill. And
of course.
You know, conformationally is going to pull. You know, I mean, there's not a big enough bit in the world that's going to solve that problem. Your horse is conformationally downhill. So you need to learn how to work around that. You know, how to help the horse. You know, how to help the horse out with its conformation so you'd be successful at its job.
And the minute you go into that mindset that the horse is not a slave, the horse is our friend, I think you can really start to understand where the horse is coming from. You can, if you can think like a horse, you will go far. You don't have to be talented. I mean, you know, George Morris, all these wonderful professionals, they learn through experience. They put themselves in the horse's, you know, shoes and said, how can I train this horse? How can I make him understand what I want him to do through education and application?
Right. Instead of like force, you know, like educate the horse instead of just saying you're going to do this. So
absolutely. You can't grab a horse by its throat and say you will. They're 2,000 pounds. I would love to see you try. It's never going to work.
They're never going to do anything. You're never going to force a horse to do anything it doesn't want to do.
And I think, you know, as a rider yourself, you can relate to the fact that a lot of people want to muscle a horse. You feel him strong. You want to, you know, I was guilty of it too, right? I'm like, God, this thing is so strong. What am I going to do? And instead of getting off and saying, you know what, today's not my day to work on this issue, let me look at the past to understand the present.
So from a beginner perspective, like, you know, why don't we unbox bidding and make it like to the bare bones and maybe help us understand the horse's mouth conformationally and how the simplest bits work and, you know, and how you design them.
Yeah, of course. I think when we look at how a bit works, its function is more complicated than people think. It goes inside the horse's mouth, but doesn't sit on the teeth. The horse has a lot of nerves and sensitivity in its mouth. So we have to be careful that what we're putting in their mouth is doing right by them. And well, because the cheek pieces have different effects on the horse as well. Some provide pull pressure, some provide curb pressure, some help with turning, some help with, you know, they all have a function and they affect the way a horse carries themselves. With that said, they work that way in combination with how a rider uses their hand, how they use their leg, how effective they are in the tack in general. So what I would use on a horse is going to be completely different than what you would use on a horse because we have different styles, which is what makes us all individual riders. If we were all cookie cutter, well, we wouldn't need trainers, would we?
I mean, yeah, we'd all be great. We'd all be Olympians right out of the gate.
Exactly. So when we talk about simple bits, no bit is really simple. And when I design them, and I come from a point of how can I provide a solution for every horse and every rider, right? So the design process just starts at the very, very base level of, you know, if I was that kind of rider, what would I want? And if I was that type of horse, what would I need? And then I try to work backwards, right? I say that a lot, working backwards, because you need to start at the finish line when you're dealing with bits and helping and consulting. You know, I've had the privilege of being at Farmhouse in Ocala several times, and soon I'll be in Tryon as well to help your customers. And a lot of the questions I get asked are really from a point of not knowing. And a lot of riders, and I try to explain to most riders, don't feel bad that you don't know, because these 5-star Olympic riders also don't know. So
you don't know what you don't know until someone teaches you. I mean, it's that simple.
And I think that's why this is going to be such a valuable series. And I really want to hear from the clients. What do they want to know? What kind of perspective can the both of us bring from a professional side and an amateur side, right? What can we both give input and feedback on for the viewers and in our customers to make them succeed? Because that's why we're doing this.
Correct. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. What are the most common questions or issues you see out there? What is the most common thing that you get asked as a bit?
The most common question would be, why did you make a bit so strong? It's a good question, except I again, we'll go back to the bit's only as strong as you make it. So I think the question really, to me as a bit maker, designer, should be, you know, when the clients ask that, why is your hand so bad? So you have to pull in order for...
What are they leaning on? Yeah.
Exactly. So, you know, if I tie a string to a loose string snaffle on a strong horse, and I tell that rider, if you pull hard enough, that string's going to come undone and you're going to end up in the dirt. I guarantee you they're not going to pull. And magically, the horse isn't strong. They'll say, but Adam, that makes no sense. That's ridiculous. If the horse is strong, the horse is strong. Well, maybe you're making it strong.
Maybe you have an electric seat, you know, maybe you've got too big of a spur, like.
Right. Let's look at all the other elements. You know, you can use other tools. We can use other tools to help us through nose pressure, through other means, instead of just putting a strong bit in a horse's mouth. If you pull and rip a horse's face off enough times, they just become numb to it. Same like a spur.
It just means nothing. Yeah.
And then, of course, you got to go stronger and stronger and stronger with your bit. And then they blame everyone and everything else why that horse isn't going the way they want. And they have two down in the ring every time.
You know, and I see so many horses out there that are pulling that, you know, just haven't learned how to use their hind end. And the rider hasn't learned to teach the horse how to get on its hind end and carry itself freely, you know, without pulling, you know, or rooting or, you know, so, I mean, there's absolute validity to that statement.
So I think, you know, to sort of summarize, I think it's really important, you know, through this segment that we help, you know, you guys, the viewer, understand how do we find solutions to my horse being strong? How do we find solutions to, you know, different things, the horse not turning right or left, you know, all sorts of things I hear in a day. You know, I think we have to address those issues to make the sport a better place for the horses and for our riders.